If you want to feed the dogs, take some of the treats. I'm going to warn you right now, the two dogs, the black one is Naya, that's mom. She is a delicate, dainty princess. And when you hold the treat out, she will take it really, really carefully. If she takes it at all, because she's also a princess and she's spoiled rotten. Kuma is an enthusiastic eater. And by enthusiastic eater, I mean think Shark Week. So if you take a treat and go to feed it to Kuma, please don't hold it in your fingers like this, because he won't bite you, but just like any shark that loves you with his, he'll lunge for the treat and he'll end up taking, this far. So the best way to give Kuma the treat is to put it in your palm like you're feeding a horse, your fingers flat. But he'll also slobber a little bit. We used to bring paper towels to hand out, but we thought that just seemed kind of awkward at conventions. So I'm going to hand you this. Take treats. Pass, take one down. Pass it around. The reason why my wife said the treats are for the dogs, we were in Wichita, Kansas 4 years ago. It was one of the first times we did this panel. And instead of handing the tray down and just letting you take them yourself, I was handing out treats. There was a teenage boy over there that said, I'll take one. So I gave him one. And he's like, I want one. So I gave... And I'm stupid. I'm just here, and whoever's raising their hand. I gave that kid 9 treats before it finally occurred to me, hey, I've seen you before. And he didn't have any. He was eating them. They were dog treats. I'm like, what is wrong with you? And I was all mad, and I was trying to make an example of him for being an idiot. And I was the idiot. The kid came to the convention. He had enough money to buy a badge. He did not have enough money for a hotel room or food. It was Saturday afternoon. He hadn't eaten since Thursday when he got to the convention. And he was sleeping in his car in the parking lot. And so right after I called him out publicly and made an idiot out of him, he told that story. I'm like, I'm so sorry. We're taking up a collection right now. That kid made more money at that panel than I did the whole weekend. Just for eating dog treats. If I knew there was a future in that, I'd do it too. And every once in a while, we will just use beef jerky stuff because it's cheaper than dog treats. Well, as silly as it sounds, there's more regulations for the dog food than there is human food. So it's okay if you poison your child, just not your pet.
That's a really awkward samurai dance sound.
I'll own that. You're recording that, aren't you?
Got it
right while I'm being all, yay, because nobody's filming, I'm going to get away with that. That's like me twerking at the charity auction and getting caught on film.
At least you weren't singing.
At least I wasn't. That would have been next. Okay, are we ready to start talking about puppies?
I think so.
Good, talk.
But we need to block the back door because that means I will be very quickly
I will
letting
do that.
My animals. All right.
Hey, Dave. You're not Dave.
No.
You were misnamed. All right. You can come and go from the panel if you want to leave. That's great. But since we are going to, the way this works now that we gave you treats, Jill's going to take the puppies off leash. She's going to let them wander around. They will come through the aisles so you can feed them, pet them, take their pictures. But we want the back door closed because Naya is an escape artist. As soon as she gets bored with the treats, she will look for the exits, and you watch. She'll do it. She'll be wandering around, and then she'll stop moving, and then you're going to find her sniffing at corners because she's trying to find her way out. Has anybody ever had a husky? Huskies are the same way. No matter how much they love you in their home, if you leave the door open, they're gone, and they are on their way to Alaska to compete in the Iditarod. Naya does the same thing, but she's just looking for the kitchen.
She snuck into the restaurant kitchen at a hotel we were at once during this panel.
Jefferson City, Missouri.
There was a little alcove that just looked like another one of these little sections where the section dividers get tucked. We didn't think anything of it till about halfway through the panel, and Naya was missing. And we went and looked, and that corner actually had a door. It was a service hallway back to the kitchen. And we're like, oh my God. So we go charging down the hallway, and she's sitting there at the stove, and the staff are feeding her hamburger.
out who she was, where she came from, but nobody came down the hallway to find out whose dog it was. They were all just in a circle feeding.
Because she just came and sat and begged pretty. It's like, great. Who else would?
All right. Are we ready?
All right. So, quick introductions. This is Naya. Naya turns 11 in about 3 weeks. She is a very old girl, but she is very cute. She is about 3/4 deaf now. So if there's a loud enough noise, she listens, but she'll pretty much ignore her name. I apologize, but if she looks your way and you kind of wave at her, she'll look for food.
We still haven't figured out whether she's actually losing her hearing or whether it's just selective. Because she hears treats, cookies, she comes running. Naya, bath time.
We'll see how well she does with her obedience tricks here, because she knows that they've been trained in Japanese commands, but since she doesn't hear as well, we'll see if she actually listens to the hand signals too. All right, Naya, Ote, come on. You are a princess, and you can touch my hand. She loves to do the offering her paw thing, but doesn't want you to actually touch it.
You may kiss the ring.
Fuse. Fuse. Good girl. All right, now we'll see if she'll do the cute one. Are you ready, Naya?
Hi, hi.
Yes! We taught our dog to army crawl. Don't judge us. It's a ninja stealth skill. Actually, if you're familiar with Japanese architecture, they build the houses. The floor is up off the ground just a little bit. And they put the tatami mats are laid down over a wooden frame. So you can literally crawl under a house and come up through the floor, which is like every horror movie I ever had as a kid.
Naya does that in snowdrifts. She'll crawl and tunnel into them and stick just her nose out, which is impossible to see. But then when you yell for her, and after you've gone and gotten dressed, put on snow boots and clothes, you go out in the backyard going, "Where did the dog go?" And when you get close to her, that you finally actually see that little nose, she will pop out of the snowdrift in an explosion of fluff and go running big circles. But she will tunnel in and make a little cave in snowdrifts. She loves snow. All right, this is Kuma. Kuma is 8 years old. He is one of Naya's puppies. This is one of her sons.
He was born in our living room.
He fit on Dan's hand when he was born.
We have a picture of him right there.
He didn't stay that little for very long.
That's because he was a pig. Our first litter, Naya had 4 puppies, and we weren't going to keep any of them. We were going to sell them all because we needed to. And my son noticed that he was the dominant one of the 4, so he got the most food. And in the puppy nest, he would push into the middle, shove all the other puppies out of the way, and then roll over onto his back and fall asleep with that huge milk belly. So my son started calling him Little Fatso. And we didn't want him to grow up with a complex, so we named him. And you know, if you name something, you have to keep it. This is why I didn't name my kids till they were teenagers. I wanted to be sure. But we named him Kuma because he looks kind of like a bear now, and it's a common Japanese name for an Akita because they're known as bear dogs. But when he was a tiny puppy, his red fur is all black tipped, and he has black claws. He looked like a freaking grizzly bear cub, because when puppies are little, their ears aren't up, they're just turned over. He looked exactly like a bear cub. And our vet in Iowa freaked out when we brought him in. He was like a week old. He's like, "You brought me a bear cub." And he ran out of the exam room with our puppy and was running down the hallway going into the room showing all of his staff and everybody else that there's a bear in Iowa.
He was punking all of his vet staff. We didn't get the puppy but Kuma back for 45 minutes because they were all doing selfies with the bear cub.
Well, it's a lot safer with a puppy than a real grizzly bear. You've seen the people on the videos on YouTube that are taking a selfie with the bear running up behind them. We consider that natural selection.
Alright, so this is Kuma. I'll have him do a couple tricks in just a minute. But he is a red sesame color. Any of you familiar with Shiba Inus, the little Japanese dogs? Red sesame is very, very common. As Dan mentioned earlier, in the Akitas, it's an incredibly recessive coloration, meaning it's not common. And his coloration is about 1 in 5,000 for the breed. And historically, for the Akita in Japan, was one of the most sought after colors. That solid sesame, very uncommon. Now, here in the Midwest, that no longer holds true. Because Kuma is still a stud dog, and that means he's had baby Kumas, and he's thrown what's considered true to color. There are lots of mini Kumas running around the country now, particularly the Midwest.
There are 19 little Kumas all over the Midwest. He's single-handedly, oddly.
Direct progeny. He's got 19 little red sesame, well, big red sesame, Akita pups. All right, Kuma, are you ready to do some tricks? Will you ote? Good boy. Kuma, will you fuse? All right. Kuma, will you kami?
Kami, all the way over.
Good boy. I know.
What? Nye crawls, he rolls. He used to roll all the way over because that's the kami is rolling. And he's gotten so lazy because as soon as he starts to tip over, everybody goes, oh, because he's adorable. He reaches out his paw, so now he doesn't roll all the way over. He just goes, here I am.
All right,
Mate.
Kuma suari. Hey, mate. He's like, but Naya's getting more food than I am. Oi, good boy. All right, would you do one more for us, Kuma?
He does Kuma. Another one, but please, when you have him running around, don't ask him to do this one.
This one usually leads to you and your chair and him all going over backwards.
Oh.
Yeah.
They're like, challenge accepted.
Friendship. All right, Kuma, are you ready to go collect food? Dozo.
I'm so excited.
That's how I want to die.
I never thought I'd die.
The pack of the cute fluffies.
I'd always kind of hoped.
It cracked, and then from smacking on the leash and stuff, and then the piece fell off somewhere outside this morning at 3 a.m. after Cards Against Humanity when I went to walk the dogs, and I didn't notice till this morning, and I'm like, it's not worth rewalking our loop to try to find that. I have a second badge at home for his service dog ID.
Why?
Come on, Kuma. It's okay. What? Are you going to check them out? Come on, buddy.
No.
I'm coming. There you go.
What happened to us?
Yeah. Kuma does slobber a lot more than Naya.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. He's lying. I'm staying in this.
Come on, dog. Get here. It's rope. Oh.
If you're going back, I'll go up front.
You go up front.
I'll go up front.
Kuma follows mom, mostly.
Come on, dog. Come on, dog.
Everyone, have any treats? You gotta go and sit down. They're here to feed you and give you treats.
There you go.
And slide into the stand. It's okay, buddy.
She's actually eating treats longer than she normally does. She usually eats like five.
He's like, good, I gotta go check on here and check on that.
It's not sirloin.
Oh, dog. Doggo.
Yeah. Well, this is why you sit next to somebody wearing blue jeans or a long sleeve shirt, because you can just wipe your hands on down. And see if they're not paying attention, it's better yet, because then you can just kind of have
this is the happiest day of my life.
She's very dainty.
The doggo.
I will sacrifice you to the maintenance gods so that Seven Ball starts flying again.
Come on, Kuma, let's go get more cookies.
Yes,
I'm going to have a diamond looking.
Do a cookie. Should I get a good picture?
For the dog, we bring his kids.
Goodbye, dog.
That's all she does.
I'm the dog.
You realize when we get home, the worst. She just immediately goes to the dogs and plays with them and makes them food, and I stand there helpless going, what about me? She's like, we have a microwave and a refrigerator. And I can't use the microwave because she's warming up the dog's food.
What a beautiful baby boy.
It's not just her. We actually get to take the dogs to conventions all over the country now. And we will go when conventions take us out to...
How's it going?
We went to a convention in Ohio where they took us to a Brazilian steakhouse. That's the... You've been to one, they're really expensive, but they come to your... And you don't get to take to-go containers at a resort. It's kind of like a buffet thing. My wife showed the wait staff pictures of our dogs and explained that they were back in the hotel room. Back in August when we were at this convention in Ohio, they sent her back to our hotel room with a pound and a half of sirloin, chicken,
and ribeye,
fish,
and
ribeye, and bacon for the dogs. For the dogs. And I asked if I could have a to-go container to take the two pieces of meat that I was just too stuffed to eat, and they said, no, we have a strict rule.
Dogs.
What? Did you find the treat bowl?
And then the lady at the front desk looked at me and she was like, and don't even think about taking one of their pieces of meat.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm never washing my hands again. That's not disturbing at all.
He's going to follow me now with the treat bucket.
He used to do that. I used to just walk by with the thing for you to take treats out of, and she'd let him off leash too early, and he'd just walk behind me. Naya's still learning treats, though. You'd think we haven't fed the dogs all week. You'd think our guest handler didn't spoil the dogs by making them their own batch of cookies.
Double care packages.
And two dogs at the same time.
She mails us cookies. And the dog, even through the sealed plastic bag, bubble wrap, and the envelope, when I go to the mail and come in with this package of cookies, they're all over me. They're like drug sniffing dogs. Or sugar cookies.
It's the best day. And a mini's got one like this.
Where's my puppy noodle?
So it's basically a key of crack. And so they have part of the bag left in the room.
Okay, go down this one. Look, right here.
You missed it. You'll have to pull it up.
Oh boy, yes, you do slob it.
Look at us, and then run over the door and then look back at us.
I'm okay with that.
As long as she doesn't try to drive, she'd never do that.
Once more, all these boys like
I don't want to talk. It's not good for me. I'm not used to talking while the puppies are running around because nobody listens.
What?
Well, normally when we do the Akita panel, the dogs go around and have treats and you pet them. And Jill actually has a full historical lecture on the history of Akitas and their development and their use in Japan. And it's awesome and there's tons of information and half of the audience doesn't listen because, look, puppies! And if I do that, no one listens and it's devastating.
Tell the bird story!
I can actually tell stories about the puppies, so yeah.
Tell
the
bird story!
Because Akitas were actually domesticated about 5,000 years ago in Japan and they were used as guard dogs. But they were also used as hunting dogs because one Akita could chase down a bear or drive him off, and two could actually take down the Japanese bear. I know that sounds, you look at the dogs going, there's no way. Japanese bears are not the same as Kodiak bears or grizzly bears. Japanese bears are about 250 to 400 pounds, and Kuma weighs 125. So a pair of Akitas would be almost the same. And they could take down bears. They were used for hunting, Akitas are actually really good bird dogs because they're very enthusiastic. They chase everything. They will not fetch. Akitas are smart and stubborn. If you throw something and they go get it and bring it back, if you throw it again, they assume you don't want it. So he'll fetch once, but he won't do it a second time. He just looks at me like I'm an idiot. But they love birds. And this guy, we have a split level foyer. Our backyard is fenced. We have a 4 foot high black fence. And when we got the backyard fenced in, we could just put the dogs out and let them play. And our neighbors, we noticed we put the dogs out. Our neighbors started bringing lawn chairs into their backyards and turning them so they were facing our house. And my first thought was, my wife is getting undressed in the window. And I'm going, Jill? And she's like, don't look at me. It's not even funny anymore. Fine. So we put the dogs out. And next thing you know, the neighbors are out sitting in chairs. I'm like, what is going on? And we ask the neighbors, and they're like, don't you watch what your dog does in the yard? I'm like, no, we let him do his business in private. Like, no, you got to watch. So we put the dogs out, and we'd go stand in the yard. And Kuma would just stand there and look at us. And the neighbors are like, why are you in the yard? Go back inside. We want to watch the show. What are you talking about? And they're like, next time you put the dogs out, just come out the front door, come around to our house, and come in the backyard and watch. I'm like, okay, fine. It took that to get an invitation to your house. But we put the dogs out and went out the door, in, and then went to... The whole neighborhood is, and it's a new development, so there's houses and there's a field behind us. It's a cornfield still behind us. We have a deck that's like 10 feet off the ground, and birds would come and sit on the deck. And when birds take off to fly, if they're not under duress, they're lazy. They drop and use gravity to gain momentum, then they open their wings and they fly off. So birds would come up to the 10-foot deck and kind of zoom and then level off and take off. So we're over at the neighbor's watching, and here's our 4-foot black fence. There's the deck. Here goes the bird, vroom, and levels off, and all of a sudden, Kuma appears. Jumping for the bird above the fence. I mentioned Shark Week. Did you see the Air Jaws episode where the great whites come up to hit the seal and go completely above the water and flip? He does that. With birds, it's so 4 feet, you can't see him, and then all of a sudden, boom, and then back down, and all the neighbors going, yay! Free Willy with fur! And it was awesome entertainment until the day he got one. Because the bird went, vroom, and Kuma went up, and it exploded. I mean, it was feathers everywhere, and our next-door neighbor had a 4-year-old kid that saw it happen. And of course, that was the time we're over there in their garden. It's all going great, and we're sharing soda and talking about, hey, you got anything left in the vegetable garden? You guys are awesome. We should do a cookout. And then all of a sudden, boom, this 4-year-old goes, Mommy. The kid's 9 now. He still won't come over to our house.
What did they think was going to happen?
I don't know. They weren't thinking it through. But that's so cute. Wham! And he used to. I mentioned the deck is 10 feet off the ground. The birds would build a nest there, and they stopped doing it because... He's an enthusiastic bird dog. The birds built a nest there. We put the dogs out. And one day, we're in the living room, we're watching TV, and all of a sudden, wham! And the house shook. And we thought, oh, we've got condos across the street with young people. So we're used to drunken stupidity happening. And we heard, wham! And the house shook. My first thought was one of our idiot neighbors just drove into our house. Because that happens. I'm like, what in the world? And we're looking around, and all of a sudden, wham! It hit again. I'm like, that's front door, nothing. Wham! I'm like, that's coming from the back of the house. And we went and looked, and Kuma was jumping and tearing the bird nest out from under the deck. and the only way he could get his nose in was to slam the top of his head into the bottom of the floorboards. So he's going, wham, and pulling on it.
This explains the brain damage.
I know, right?
Self-inflicted.
But he was really happy. Yeah, when he finally got the whole nest, he just stood there and looked around like he was waiting for the applause. Ta-da! I got all three of those nests. Okay, that was me stalling. It's your turn. You can do the actual dry, boring history stuff. I'll just be stupid.
All right, we'll do really fast points about Akitas in history.
Look, I was kidding. It's not really a boring lecture at all.
I do love your dog.
Thank you.
Aw, that's like the nicest thing anybody ever says to me. I love your dogs.
They say they love your wife.
Yeah, but I shot that guy. We show up at conventions, and we got here at 1:45 in the morning, Friday morning, and come to check in, and I get the same thing from conventions everywhere around the country. I walk in to get our keys and stuff, and the first thing any of the staff want to know is, where are the dogs? Really, you're not going to let me check into my room? Yeah, where are the dogs? They normally get their own badges. We were at Anime Central 3 years ago and took the dogs, and they have a private dining room in the hotel that the guests of honor, the important people, get access to the private dining room where they get this 4-star restaurant with menus with no prices on them. So you just order whatever you want and they feed you. It's an awesome con. The year we brought the dogs, they got their own guest of honor badges with a tag on the back that gave them access to the private dining room, and I didn't have access to the private. No kidding, they did it on purpose. So I had to borrow Kuma's badge to go eat all weekend.
And they made the badge checker at the door make sure he flipped it over so they could say, all right, Mr. Kuma, have a good meal.
Onikon and Galveston invited the dogs back for this year and not me. They gave me a free badge anyway, just because I'm their driver.
I think your badge actually says dog's driver on it, too. They said it's
just wait until it says
cheese
and hat.
Jeeves?
And hat.
And hat.
You don't have to worry, they have self-driving cars now.
Alright, so
look, I have one job. And now you're taking it away from me too. So you're just gonna send the car for the dogs. And as long as there's treats in the car, when it rolls up and the door opens, the dogs will get in the car. Naya will get in anybody's car. So if you're leaving in the parking lot and Jill's walking the dogs and you open your door and say, Naya, she will get in the car with you.
This is why they're on leashes. All right, everything you didn't want to know about Akitas in 10 minutes or less. All right, Akitas are the largest Spitz breed in Japan. They are native to Akita Prefecture, which is where they get their name. They have been a recognized dog breed and documented for over 2,500 years, with their heritage going back almost 5,000 years in Japan. They are one of the oldest dog breeds in the world. Now, you will typically see them more with their tails really up and curly. As they get old, they get lazy. Most of us can relate to that. Little kids have way more energy than the rest of us. If we could bottle it, that'd be great, but we can't. So we have Akitas, known for their wolf shape, their large head and smaller nose, and bear-shaped head. As Dan mentioned, they were used and domesticated as fantastic hunters for small game, large game, and protection. Not only did they hunt bear, they helped keep the bear out of the indigenous people's homes in the mountain areas of Japan. Because if you had a Japanese house, it was not very sturdily constructed. Remember, the walls were mostly paper, And if you had a bear decide that your dinner smelled good, they'd come right in. Having an Akita helped keep your family safe, as well as turn the tables so you had a new bear skin rug. And bear steaks.
Is that a thing?
Yes.
I want one.
Now that hunting also became used on the battlefield. One of the cool things in history was that the noble families, if they were actually engaged in large-scale pitched battle, would occasionally, if they were very fortunate, have a war-trained hunting Akita. And what that meant is, not only did you have an Akita to sleep on your feet and keep them warm at night and discourage ninjas from assassinating you, but when you were actually engaged in battle, you dropped the leash and sent your Akita tearing off across the battlefield to take out the commanders on the other side. This was accomplished easier than you think, because on the other side, you have thousands of troops. But the people in charge are usually sitting on war horses, which for the Japanese were war ponies, about 12 hands high. But you had a guy, highly enthusiastic, yelling orders and waving their arms around, usually holding a tessin or war fan, signaling troop movements. So you taught the dog to attack the guy yelling and waving his arms sitting on a horse. You have a 125-pound dog go tearing across the battlefield to jump the pony and take the 120-pound man off of it by the throat.
Rip his throat out.
Because if no one is commanding the other side's troops, it's much easier to defeat them. Now, as we kind of jump forwards in history, we get into when the Tokugawas took power, roughly 1600. They enforced peace in Japan, and at that point, the Akita's numbers really dwindled. They were very close to actually becoming extinct at the time of the third Tokugawa shogunate, Ieyasu. But at that point in time, one of his advisors actually convinced him that the Akitas were divine beings. They were godly, and he passed laws protecting them in Japan. He had temples built to them, set up breeding facilities, and created a really, really fun job that anybody that likes fuzzy puppies would have. This would have been the job for you in feudal Japan. I know I wanted it. In addition to raising puppies and playing with them and training them, part of these handlers' jobs was to learn the Akita's language. Now this gets silly. You guys would never guess the Japanese do anything silly. But Akitas don't typically bark. They will on occasion when they feel there's something to alert you to, but they will only when they choose to, never on command. Talk. They will do the if we leave her home for the weekend. When we get home, she will be at the top of the stairs. She will chew us out and go sit on the other side of the living room and pout that she's been left home. But Akitas will talk. Now, the handler's job was to learn their language, not just to translate what the dog said, but to speak back to them in their language. So you got to be extra silly. But remember, this is Japan, so we're going to take this one step even more crazy. This is where tentacle monsters came from. No, why?
How did that end up in our Akita panel?
To traumatize you. Now, this is the Japanese people. They can take things to an extreme. So with Akitas, that extreme was not just talking to the dogs, but I mentioned Ieyasu was convinced that they were divine beings. That means that they were direct conduits, and that meant that he kept an Akita with him at all times, so that if they chose to speak and communicate what the gods wanted, he would know. So he had an Akita in his bedchambers, in council meetings, lawmaking sessions. So there were laws created in feudal Japan simply because the dog chose to make noises. They were at trials.
How would you like to be on trial for murder? And while you're there, while they're summing up the thing, the dog all of a sudden goes, and you look over, and the interpreter is your next door neighbor, and he hates you. Dog said he did it. Dog said, I need a raise.
So Akita's actually influenced society in Japan.
They run our house.
You're just jealous that they get all the treats.
And the affection.
Aww.
That was so sweet. It would have meant more if I knew you guys actually cared about me and you weren't all in the room to see the puppies.
All right, so we kind of jump forwards again in time to the story of Hachiko. Anybody familiar with Hachiko? Excellent. Hachiko was the most famous Akita in world history, and it is his story that actually led Akitas to be protected in Japan and named a natural treasure, meaning they could no longer be hunted for their furs, and that they wouldn't become extinct in that country. Now, in 1923, Hachiko was born, and he was purchased by a professor at the University of Tokyo. That professor took him home, and with the help of his gardener, they trained the puppy to escort Professor Yuno to the train station on the outskirts of Tokyo so that he could ride the train to work. And then in the afternoon, they trained the puppy to be waiting through the evening trains so that he could safely escort his master home through the suburbs of Tokyo. Now, because having a giant wolf dog at your side helps you get home safely. It's a good deterrent in all ages. Now, unfortunately, when Hachiko was about a year and a half old, the professor passed away while he was at work. That didn't stop Hachiko's loyalty and dedication to his master. He returned every day for the remainder of his life, for the next 11, 12 years, to Shibuya train station to wait through the evening trains to see if his master would need his services to walk home. That dedication was something that the Japanese prized. They wanted their children to be that dedicated and loyal to their families, and their people to be that dedicated to their country. So Hachiko was an embodiment of that dedication and loyalty, and he was revered in Japan, as well as that his story spread worldwide and actually led to the first Akita being led out of Japan. Now that Akita, this is 1937, a couple years after Hachiko had passed away, and that Akita was presented to somebody that you guys probably know if you didn't completely fall asleep in history class in school. That'd be you. You only know this person through bad jokes.
Look, no one gets it because you haven't told who the person is yet. Okay. The punchline's coming.
So the first Akita to leave Japan was brought back to this country by somebody named Helen Keller. And now they
wow, everybody under the age of 20 is still looking blank.
Helen Keller was responsible for...
You're not under the age of 20, dude.
Helen Keller was a lady who was both blind and deaf. She was responsible for helping create Braille. She was a scholar and a world traveler. And in 1937, she actually went with an assistant to Japan and toured the country. And she had heard the story of Hachiko and was fascinated with the Akitas. Now, the Japanese people really revere two things. One was loyalty, the other is spirit. And they felt that Helen Keller embodied that spirit, that unstoppable nature, where even with all the limitations she had, it didn't stop her from becoming educated, from traveling, and being a good humanitarian. If you go through any of the texts in Japan from her visit, she's frequently referred to as Saint Keller because she was so revered there. And that was why the Japanese people arranged to actually present her with an Akita. Now, she didn't know this, but when she went to Odate in Akita Prefecture to meet an Akita, one had been arranged to present to her. However, upon getting there, the gentleman, the breeder and trainer responsible for presenting her with the adult dog, realized that with her limitations, having an adult dog, even if they were wonderful and friendly and respectful, was not going to be the best situation for her. That she really needed a puppy that could bond with her, learn her movements, learn how to help her, being both blind and deaf. And so instead of presenting her with the adult dog, he gifted her with his own 10-week-old puppy that he'd waited 2 years for in a breeding. And that was the puppy that she brought back to the States. Now, Helen Keller... Yes.
You did say she was blind and deaf?
Yes.
How does she know it was an Akita she brought back with her?
Really? There's photographic evidence, you jerk.
That doesn't help her. What, a photo in Braille, too?
Okay, Trista, put hand over mouth. His hand. You don't have to touch him, it's okay.
Yeah, I don't want to. She says that she
Oh, now even Kuma left. Wait, we might as well make this official.
You're being punished. All right, so Helen Keller had Nikita as a seeing eye dog companion and guardian for the next 13 years here in the States. And that was the first PETA out of Japan until after World War II, when we kind of forced them to surrender and took all of their things.
Right.
Yeah. I told you, this is the abbreviated history, right?
I mean,
no,
you're not.
All right. Today, there are many more Akitas in the United States, as well as throughout Europe, than there are in Japan. And that's because of resources. Japan being a very small island nation with limited resources, those resources go towards the people more than the animals. This country and in Europe, a lot more space, more resources, and ability to have large dogs that need room to run around and the ability to feed them. They are frequently today used as service animals. Akitas are very sensitive to seizures, to diabetes, and to anxiety. They're very, very commonly used for therapy. They can be trained as full seeing eye dogs, although they are somewhat stubborn. So you do have to be a little bit more picky when you're choosing a puppy for finding one with more of the temperament that's willing to listen to you than look at you and walk off. Because they don't make a good service dog if they just abandon you.
Yes.
But they are used in Japan still as police animals. They can be trained that way as well, and specifically for search and rescue. They really are very good because of their agility and their hunting ability for tracking things. They were used and still are used as search and rescue dogs, especially in avalanche and mudslide type situations where they're very good at finding people.
Kuma can find a piece of bacon under 20 feet of mud or rubble.
Have you adopted her, or are you hiding from Daddy?
No, apparently Cookies buys affection. We have, Kuma has a brother who is a service dog. One of our students is blind and in a wheelchair. He's legally blind. He can still see shapes, and I can flip him off from across the room. He'll know I did it. It really scares me, because I'll be like, and he'll just smile and look. How does he do that? But he lives in a bad part of Cedar Rapids, Iowa. And I said, he's blind, he's in a wheelchair. He'd been mugged 4 times at the ATM machine, cashing his government check to pay rent in his rent control apartment thing. 4 times in 2 years he'd been robbed. So he decided he needed a service dog.
Yeah.
So he got one of Naya's puppies that is now Kuma's size and colored like her. So he has a 125-pound gigantic black wolf dog that walks him to the ATM machine. Guess how many times he's been mugged since then?
Zero.
Zero. Zero. But that dog is a chick magnet. And this character, do you know what he's saying? He has a power chair and it's a service dog. He has convinced girls that they can only pet the dog. If you're familiar with service dogs, you're not supposed to pet. He tells girls that it is okay for them to pet the dog, but the dog's only allowed to be petted from the person in the chair, because that's how he was trained. So the girls have to sit in his lap, and then they can pet the dog. And it works! Damn. Like, why do you? I'm jealous. I didn't think of that.
That's
devious.
Yeah, the owner's clever. The dog has figured out how to open doors. And he was trying to get financing to get, if you're handicapped, you can get a refrigerator that the door is actually operated by a foot pedal. So he was going to try to teach Mirame how to open the refrigerator and bring him cans of Mountain Dew. Like, if you get that one figured out, I'm sending our dogs to you for training.
Yeah, the problem is all he did was figure out how to open the refrigerator and eat all the bacon.
Yeah, that means Paul can't keep anything in his refrigerator except for cans of soda because the dog eats everything else.
Yeah. What?
You're silly. I know you eat everything.
That was the end of my story. You can talk again.
Well, this is the point at which we have a couple minutes, so we give them question and answer time.
We give them questions?
No, they give
them
questions.
That's not fair. Come up with your own question.
How many are purple? Sorry, countries
are. Oh, no, let her go first anyway, because he's on staff. He's on staff and he wastes too much of our time anyway.
How many of her babies are service animals now?
No, there's three of them. Three of her 29 pups are fully certified service animals, and I think four or five of the others are therapy dogs.
Okay.
How many are in the show ring?
Seven of them went through to champion in the show ring across the country.
So you can get contact with the owners yet? Can you keep in contact with the owners?
Yep. Oh yeah, she doesn't keep in communication with people, but dogs.
I say we're up to great, 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 great grandbabies of hers in the show ring now. And she's 11, like next month. She's
in the blue. She looks down. You didn't know what you wore. I'm sorry, I was talking.
It's all right. Which one of the rare coloring again?
The red sesame Kuma. The red with the black tipping is the most uncommon, other than a blue brindle. Which I'll explain in just a sec. Naya is a silver brindle. She's considered a solid body brindle, which means that the white is on her paws, but it does not break up into her torso and across her body. The solid body brindle you'll see in the silver like she is, or in a red, which is the reddish color of him in the striping. That's what his dad looked like.
He looked like a tiger.
A reddish orange striped tiger dog.
Tiger bear dog. It's like a Dungeons and Dragons monster somebody just created.
Yeah. But the solid body brindle is about 1 in 500 for the breed. The most common colorations you're going to see in the Akitas are going to be solid white or pinto. And pinto can be either evenly marked with a saddle of color like an husky or malamute. Or they can kind of look like a cow dog where they have splotches of random color all over. And that color can be red, it can be brown, it can be black, it can be brindle striped. I mean, they can be completely uneven. But the pinto and the white are going to be your most common colorations.
Now, with some dog breeds, like for example, say, I'm just going to throw out there, like pugs, like when you're training them, you're not supposed to let them sit like above you on the couch because it makes them feel dominant. If you were to domesticate or train like a dog of this breed, are there any like specific nuances you should avoid when training them?
Dominance is a big issue with the Akitas. If they can run your household, they will. So just, you mentioned pugs. Yorkies are also terrible for very dominant, taking over territory. When he was about 9 months old, we had another litter of pups. And we had someone there to evaluate a pup. They were trying to decide whether they wanted to take this puppy home. They asked, you know, at that point in time, hey, can I meet the parents? Which we had Naya and Kiyoshi and Kuma all shoved in our bedroom with the door closed so that this guy could sit in our living room and play with the puppy without being overwhelmed. So we're like, yeah, sure. We go swing the door open. He's sitting in our living room on the love seat. And Naya and Kiyoshi come boiling around, all wiggly. Kuma comes boiling around after them. Gets to the around the corner of the love seat and stops and looks at this guy. Now he doesn't hackle, but he's just very stiff and just kind of looks at him. And before any of us can really do anything, because we didn't weren't sure what he was doing, he jumped on the couch and shoulder checked the guy onto the floor and just stood there like, you don't belong on my couch. Never a growl, never a sound, just shoved him to the floor and we're going, oh my God. This guy starts laughing his butt off and goes, will the puppy do that when she gets bigger? It's like, probably yes, but that's not a good behavior because we had to punish him for
after we got that
laughing. But yeah, so that they can have dominance issues. These guys are trained unless asked that they're not allowed on the furniture. So even though Dan really wants them to come up on the bed and cuddle, they'll stay for about 2 minutes and they're like, we don't belong up here, and they get back down. I know, you want a cuddly puppy and they just sit on you. But they do have tendencies to have trouble with training. The other biggest thing that people get in trouble with training an Akita is the fact that they are intelligent. And think of having an ADD child who is very, very intelligent.
Yeah, nobody in the room relates to that.
When someone's teaching you something, once you have it, if they keep making you do it over and over again, your attention's gone. Because it's like, yeah, I already got that. What else do you have? Akitas usually, they're very treat-driven. You probably figured that out already. But as puppies, you train with treats, and you'll have them sit. You push their butt down, say the word, give them the treat. They get up and romp around. You have them come back. You tell them to sit. They'll usually do it on their own. You give them the treat. By the third time, they'll do it, but they'll look at you like, all right, this is getting old. And if you don't change what you're asking them to do, they'll wander off because they think you're an idiot repeating the same thing over and over again. They train very quickly, so you have to be on top of that as far as giving them more things to do. By 8 weeks old, every litter of puppies we had that left our house was fully housebroken, leash trained, would sit and lay down and come on command because they learn really quickly. And that's the biggest thing that gets people in trouble in training an Akita is they get bored and they'll decide that they don't need to listen to you. So you have to work with that mentality. They're nowhere near as obnoxious as Shibas, the little Japanese dogs.
Yeah.
We'll do one more fun story because everybody sees an Akita and goes, they're so beautiful, I want one. But I'm gonna get one of the little ones. I'll get a Shiba because they look the same and obviously they'll be the same. And then we get hate mail. One of my best friends got a Shiba puppy, 8-week-old Shiba puppy. And they look like a little bitty fox, but Shiba puppies get to 15 to 20 pounds when they're full grown. Akitas, 90 to 120. Now they take home this 8-week-old Shiba puppy, and not only is it terrorizing their house and destroying couches and ripping things to shreds, but it's hyperspastic and very clever, and it can escape any crate that they put it in. But they get about a week and a half along, and they have friends over for a barbecue in their backyard. Now they have a house that's built partway into a hill, so the backyard has a retaining wall of bricks that comes around, and then on the front corner of the house, there's a fence with a drop-off to the street. Now, before the barbecue, they had been trying to figure out how, for the first week and a half, every toy they got this puppy disappeared. Until they noticed that their neighbors had put a basket with please return toys here in front of the fence because the Shiba would run out the back door every time it heard someone, run to the front with a toy and throw it through the fence to get them to play and to give it to other dogs and people walking by. So they finally figured out where all the toys were going, and then we get to barbecue time. Now nothing is worse than a very, very, very hyper good jumper and a hot barbecue grill.
Oh. Hot dog, hot dog.
So after they finally captured the puppy that kept jumping at the grill, highly enthusiastic about eating the hamburgers and hot dogs, they got the puppy, they chucked her in the house, closed the screen door. About 30 seconds later, they hear thwappity thwappity thwap, and then here opens the screen door with the Shiba hanging on the latch, kicking, dropping, and running a circle to launch at the barbecue grill again. So, okay, they finally all chase down and corner the Shiba, grab her, toss her back in the house, and close the storm door too, because obviously a heavy door is gonna be a better deterrent. Well, that was true, but that meant about 5 minutes later, here goes the Shiba down the roof and around the retaining wall. They had a chimney. They had a fireplace, and she could hear their voices echoing in the flue, and she went up it and down the roof. Now, it took them about half an hour to capture her because that meant she was loose in the neighborhood on the retaining wall. But they had to permanently board over their fireplace until she got too big to go up the flue and would just get stuck. She also had to have a major bath after all the soot, but hey, they didn't need a chimney sweep for a while. But Shibas are devilishly intelligent and hyper, and they make Akitas look very tame for their dominance issues. I love them to pieces, but you have to know what you're in for when you get a Shiba, or they will run everything and you will never catch them again. They're also much louder and more vocal. But, all right, did he get to ask his question?
No, I would.
So have you trained your Akitas to attack crazy guys on horses waving their arms wild?
Yes. Yes, we have the large arm movement. So if you see us after the panel walking the dogs, nod, but don't wave.
All right, we had one more question.
I have heard that German shepherds understand German a lot better, so you can train them to use German. Is it kind of the same way with your dogs?
That sounds racist.
The biggest reason they train a dog in a different language is so that it doesn't ruin their obedience hearing a command that they're supposed to listen to over and over again, because the first thing that happens when you take a cute fuzzy dog out in public is everybody goes, "Aw, they're so cute, sit, shake." And if they don't know what associate those words and sounds with an action they're supposed to do, it doesn't ruin their training. If they're hearing a word they're supposed to respond to and they ignore it repeatedly, it actually makes it harder for them to listen to what they're supposed to obey for their handler. And that's actually the biggest reason they started training. For the German, it's partially the language, it's also partially the words that they use as commands are very different. They just have, so it's easier for the dog to understand because it's not guessing on two words that sound really similar. But for them being trained in Japanese, one, we knew they were gonna be traveling all over the country with us, and they're stubborn enough, so training them in a language other than English.
And it made sense to teach Japanese dogs Japanese commands. We thought about Russian for a while, but it seemed awkward.
But it also made it really fun for our summer camps at our martial arts school, because we'd bring the puppies in and we'd teach the kids all the commands in Japanese, and so they'd get a vocab lesson, and then they'd get to feed the puppies treats and have them do obedience tricks. But that was extra fun because before we brought the dogs in, while the kids learned the words, we gave them candy.
We made the kids practice on each other. Sawadi, sawadi, and make the kids like, ukemi, and get the kids. It was adorable.
That's fantastic.
It was probably wrong, but there was no recording.
All right, I have one more thing for you. Those of you that, one, want to pick on Dan, and are interested in
his novel. Have we not done that this weekend?
No. They don't know this. So Dan's first novel, it's a werewolf novel. It has violence and fun and fight scenes and other stuff in it and motorcycles. But in the novel, you know how most novelists will dedicate their first book to someone that, you know, help them, encourage them to write, things like that. You know, sometimes, you know, I don't know, their wife. This novel was dedicated to Kuma. And it is actually pautographed. So we do have copies of Fenris Ferrar that are pautographed, and if you really want Dan's signature, you can have him autograph them too.
You know, I'll sign Kuma's name to it. In my defense, I was going to dedicate the book to her, but when the book was being published, he was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease, and we didn't know at the time that he was going to make it. I mean, this was devastating. I love him more than I do my children. I mean, it's a huge big deal.
No one blames
and
you.
A specialist was able to diagnose what was wrong with him and put him on medication, and so he's been fine. But in the meantime, we decided to dedicate the book to him, and he was so adorable. One of my students made a joke about, well, did he sign the book? So Jill's like, make that happen. And got an ink, you know, the ink pad thing, and Kuma will let her handle him. And so he's like, lay down, Kuma, here, give me your paw. And she rolls his paw and signs it. Naya, on the other hand, we tried to do that once with her, and there were 30 footprints across our hardwood floor, ink blot, ink blot, ink blot, scrabble, scrabble, ink blot, of her escaping and running all over the house while Jill's chasing her with the blotter and a book, going, Naya, get back here.
About the time we'd get the ink on her foot is when she'd go like mad scrabble kick and bolt.
Difficult
yes.
child. Yes.
I know, you are a princess.
Right.
But If you guys have any more questions about Akitas, feel free to ask us. You can also find us on Facebook, message me. I can put you in contact with different breeders across the country, as well as different rescues and stuff. There are some fantastic Akita rescues around. There's two different. There's one breeder directly here in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area that has some fantastic pups, if you're interested in that avenue. Other than that, you guys are released.
You guys are awesome. Thank you very much.